IVM.
All right, you guys, if you like to watch movies and TV shows, not only watch, but binge watch, then here's a cool new recommendation for you. Check out Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, a show hosted by Anirudh Guha and his wife Janice. Both of them sit and watch TV shows through the entire week and then come and review it. It's a fun little show and I really loved listening to it. You should too. Check it out on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Hello everybody, you're listening to Keeping It Queer with me, Navin Noronha.
And Farhad.
Welcome to Keeping It Queer, you guys. As you can see, our concerns are beyond everybody else's problems. Like, people are talking about Kashmir issue, world hunger, you know, global warming. And we are like, pawn nahi aa raha hai ghar mein. What the fuck is that about?
It all comes back to censorship and
exactly.
Repression.
Hilaya nahi to khujaya kha. That's the opening of my show.
No. I'm
sorry. Welcome, Farhad, to the show.
Hi, Naveen.
How do you
Hi.
Feel being a co-host today as well?
Bitch, I am the co-host. What
like,
does that mean?
Like, it's a sarcastic
Oh,
comment.
Okay. Very nice. Lovely. Great. I'm having a good time.
Nice, dear.
Thanks.
Okay, and because Farhad couldn't take the fact that I had my best friend come on the show, he's got his best friend on the show
Yay!
Today.
And
introduce
You know, yeah. I was going to say like, oh, my best friend Mansher on the show today. Then I was like, you know what, best friend's too slam bookie.
Or will it be like nepotism?
And then, you know,
best
and this happened
show.
While showering. So it was like a thinking thing. And then I was like, you know what, Mansher's a... Friend. He's a friend.
Holistic.
Yeah, like a friend. You know, you're a friend.
With like the emphasis.
Hi, Mansher.
Hi, Farhad. Hi, Naveen. Thank
hi,
you.
Man,
thank you for having me.
Why have we got Mansher?
Yeah, why have you got
Mansher? Why have you?
I'm
asking you the same question.
First of all, though, I pretty much know that everybody who's listening to this, like 90% know Mansher already.
No way.
I have a feeling. Okay. I have a feeling. Everybody
because
knows
you
Mansher.
Feature very highly on his Instagram.
Exactly.
Not just on my Instagram, in everyone's life. Like literally, yeah. Mansher remembers everyone. Everyone kind of, because of his personality, everybody remembers Mansher.
Yeah. Because like, I met you only once and the same evening where you rebuked me for being on my phone while at your house. But
this was 2 years ago probably.
Almost 2 years ago. And I did not know anybody, as I said. Like, you know, but then we broke conversation because of the fact that your roommate is a co-writer and comedian.
Exactly.
So like, I was like, hey, it makes sense. So like, as he said, like almost 90% of the people default know you because of somebody.
But we're all kind of connected in the same way, right?
Yeah.
The kind of context we're a part of, what we're interested in. I mean, it's pretty small that way.
Yeah.
And where we live. Look at where we live, for example.
Yeah. We're all car boys now.
Bandra
boys. Car Bandra.
Yeah,
Bandra car.
He's Pali Hills. So.
I mean, I'm Pali Naka. Come on.
But to climb the hill, you have to go to the Naka.
Exactly.
That's an important thing.
Exactly. I'm with the people in
the
Naka.
You're the gatekeeper of Pali.
Shut up. What is this conversation?
But how did you two meet?
How did we meet? We met through a friend.
We met through a mutual friend, a roommate that I no longer talk to. But we became friends because his roommate for 2 years wanted to live at my house and I didn't have a space for her. So I sent her to Farhad because Farhad was looking. And then they got along like a house on fire.
Yeah.
And they invited me over for dinner one night. And it's been just so intense and so amazing since then.
Because I'm great.
Like intensely fun, intensely good.
Yeah.
Not intense in like a dramatic way. There's no drama.
None.
Yeah.
But also, have you had like very intense queer friends before this, or like was this your first experience?
No, I've had queer friends, sure, but like I think Farhad, intense in that he's opened up this entire subculture, especially like
exactly.
I think in this part of India that I'd never accessed before.
Well, before I met you on his Instagram, I would think that because you're always on his lap and everything, I'm like, okay, he's one of his boy toys, obviously.
No, my God.
I'm sorry. But like then I met you and I'm like, oh, you're so well versed with the fact that there's an entire subculture within the queer community.
Yeah.
That some people are just like,
I
okay
can
with opening
tell
up
you
to
right that. Now that Mansher has been for more Pride marches than I have.
I think
easily.
I think we actually met at Pride in 2017.
Yeah.
We weren't friends yet.
It was amazing. You know, time slowed down because that was another one of those markers in my friendship with Mansher where I was like, you know what, this guy is amazing. It was, you know, this was the year where they were suddenly expecting some 5,000 people, but some 14,000 people showed up.
Oh my God, it was amazing.
So they did these
amazing.
Three, they broke it up, the march into three.
Correct.
And I remember I was looking for a friend, so I'm walking against
looking
the grain.
For a
I was looking for a friend. And that gap between those two giant groups, Mansher was at the center. Like, no one was around him, and he was just like, I don't know
it
if
it wasn't like that. I wasn't completely
was,
alone.
It played out like that in my head. Like, you were like, you know, like he was. Not 377 type chanting, but he was there. He was there for all of us. Okay. Yeah.
Trying to be a good ally and all that.
Yeah.
Whatever that means.
And I think we also met at the Pride this year.
Yeah. No, 2018.
Which was last year, correct?
2018. When you had just been featured for Farhad on a guest spot on one of your podcasts or something like that. You guys had just started this Keeping It Queer business.
It's too much intricacies right now.
Done.
Nobody cares.
We all know each other. We all love each other. That's the takeaway.
The 90% people who know Mansher out there now know that this is how we all met. Yeah. And it's a small world. It's a beautiful world.
Yeah.
But what are we talking about today, guys?
Well, I thought that actually Mansher came up with this, which is great. You know, I think Mansher is a serial dater. Uh-huh. As in, I know he's constantly dating and we constantly have our side of dating. So I thought he could shed some light on what straight dating is like nowadays.
Ooh.
And we bring the gay side of it.
Like, so whatever you all have done.
Is that how you had it in mind?
Like, yeah, I mean, I don't think straight dating and gay dating is that different. But I mean, just...
It's not. Again, I was thinking before we had this conversation, I was like, is it any different? But I think it's very different.
Yeah,
okay. I think it's very
the most
different.
Common question I get, however, is that who's the boy, who's the girl? Like, even beyond the sexual aspect of it,
when it's a gay relationship,
yeah, because like, who's the husband, who pays
the bill, who opens the door, who puts the toilet seat down, like that basic shit, you know.
Yeah.
And then like we have to tell, like, okay, both of us suck at both of these things, you know. We have to tell each other all the time to buck up because no one's picking up each other's laundry from the ground.
Sure.
As simple as that, you know.
Sure.
So I don't know where to begin with because the gender binaries are so instilled in dating.
Yeah.
To go beyond that, to find that acceptance.
Okay, so in that sense, I want to start with, how do you meet people? Because, you know, for us, like in the gay world, a lot of this will happen in this episode, I guess, in the gay world, in the straight world. I'll try to minimize that. But like,
we're not generalizing.
For us, it's easy, right? The last 10 times I've asked a pair of boyfriends, like, how did you all meet? It's either been Grindr, Tinder, a scruff, huff, whatever.
Yeah.
But again, one of the reasons I wanted Mansher on the show is because he's not on any dating app. But he's always meeting new people. He's always kind of, sort of, if not seeing someone, having something going. Or like, so,
yeah, sure. I mean, not, it's not that kind of frequent. You know, they end up being these like very intense bursts of affection that are spread out over a couple of months.
Sure. But how do you meet them? How do you meet these people?
So again, no apps. And I think I'm in the minority over here. And it's not like I think apps are bad or whatever. I just, I don't want to make dating that much of a priority when I'm actively on an app. I think being on an app to me is someone being very active about like wanting to have sex, wanting to date. And I don't think that's a priority to me. I don't think that should be spent that much time on. It's not something you can control.
Mm.
When people enter your life and you meet them, you have a connection, great. Like, it should be natural. And I think it's, for me, unattractive to know that someone wants to date off the bat or finds me attractive. Then there's a certain like mystery and like serendipity just like gone.
Gone.
Mm. And when you do kind of meet someone and you have a connection and you can kind of let it evolve naturally, then I feel like both people are able to go in with a lot more agency and a lot more and be a lot more conscious of what they want, what their expectations are.
Sure. That's actually, the moment he said that, I'm like, I'm devoid of all of that.
There's
no mystery. Like, within 2 minutes, I know whether I'm going to fuck him in the ass or no.
Yeah.
So sad.
All the parameters
Thanks,
are broken
Mansher,
down.
What the fuck? Yeah.
I think it's so nice. Sorry, Sister, but on that, I think it's so nice to always wonder whether it's working out or not. And then you're finally at that moment where like, hey, maybe there's a connection. Mm. Maybe your lips, your eyes are matching. You're looking at each other's lips. And then
you're like, our fingers intertwine.
Exactly. No, not even like that. Not even that. But you're like, you still don't know till you know. And I find like that anticipation just so delicious.
Yeah.
I just really hope everybody you meet, their eyes are matching.
No,
because very scary.
I mean, eyes aligning, for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, butterflies are flying, exactly. All that, flowers are blooming.
But I really feel it because, and this happened I'm saying this week, I asked someone, how did you guys meet? And they said, oh, we were actually on a trip through some friends and all. And I found it tough that, the answer wasn't an online, you know, like, we met online or something.
Like, my relationship right now, did I just do a Farhad?
Are you scared? He's taking feedback very seriously, I think. Oh my gosh.
I'm sorry. So as we said, like, we don't almost meet anybody almost organically anyway nowadays, because everybody's on Grindr or whatever. My current relationship boyfriend, Abhishek, we've been dating for a year now.
Nice.
It's been a year.
Congratulations.
I'd never imagined finishing a year in any relationship, much alone this one, because there's like a 6 year age gap between us. And so how this happened was, he saw me perform live. Close to 2 years ago, he came to Bombay for a impromptu trip, saw me on stage. I don't even do any material about me coming out. I was just talking about pigeons and how I hate them. And he just saw this, like, okay, he's cute. Went back, googled my name, then found the entire chattabite of my information. Okay, his activism, whatever, podcast, you know, stand up. So then he kind of like had a crush on me. But then he never approached me for a year after that because of the fact that I was in my own bubble, he was in his own bubble, until he moved to Bombay. And then, like, when he finally found me on Grindr within that, like, 2 kilometer radius, he came in with, like, all this information on my life that he knew, like, where
that's
I was touring.
So creepy.
It's creepy. So, obviously, like, in the beginning, I was like, what the fuck, stalker, fuck off. But.
No, no, but, how did he bring it up? Like, did he.
So, what? He was like, okay, hey, are you at your show? And I'm like, yeah, I'm at my show. I'm at Habitat performing. And also, I was like, okay, there's, like, what. 10 people at my show, so like I wouldn't mind getting one person from Grindr to come to my show. I'm that desperate, I'm sorry.
So modest, so modest.
As an artist, you have to like pull every string, dude. You have to be like, I have put up my show posters on Grindr and Growler and all these apps while touring different cities. I don't care, dude.
I have to keep
hustling. So I was like, maybe he'll come to the show. But he's like, no, I know you're traveling from Bombay to Pune next, and good luck, big fan, you know, I saw you live once. I'm like, which show was this? And the whole conversation began and everything. And then, like, cut to that, the fact that we start dating and we spent like almost all the evenings together for like months together.
And nights.
And nights also. Evenings include nights.
Oh, okay,
cool. Mornings are not usually, you know, fun in Bayandar. Yeah. So, for me also, it became a fact that, okay, this guy is, you know, so into me. Like, maybe I'm not indulging as much. It was initial
too many walls
hesitation and the last relationship did a number on me on all that shit. And but this guy was just like so giving, so generous, so kind. And I was like, okay, maybe still has an ulterior motive and he's got something up his sleeve and everything. And nothing was of that sort until we had like a mini breakup, like when we started living together. And the living together was also a subject of circumstance. So when we like then just like parted ways and then we tried meeting other people, I just could not get up, dude. I could not have a boner anymore with random dudes.
Because you were so attracted to him?
My partner and I, like, we have this amazing sync now where we, even though we like, we declared open for a while, we just came back trawling to each other because of the fucking passion. And now the intensity is like even more now.
So but was it purely physical?
No, no. Initially it was physical. Then it grew into like something. Every relationship at the beginning is like something that you you go for the, again, like the best parts of the other person. You have a laundry list of, okay, check. And then you go with that. And from there on, it became like a whole different beast, you know? So I'm really happy right now in my life, at least.
I'm glad you brought that up, because I'm just going to quickly, you know, I went through the same problem when I broke up with my ex-boyfriend. I couldn't get hard for a while. And it was actually my shrink that told me that sometimes a breakup can also cause that. In my head, I was like, oh my God, is it because I'm Parsi? This is why Parsis don't. Is it because I smoke so much? Is it because of weed? You know, all those things. But it turns out it was just because every time I would chat with my ex-boyfriend, he would even message me to ask me, what's our cat, the cat that we got together, what is he doing?
Screwed,
I'm fucking at a boner, you know, like. So I was like, what's happening? So
it's also linked in your memory.
I just want to say this, because if anyone again is going through this sort of shit,
it happens.
It happens. Doesn't matter. But I want to know you, Mansher, like, what do you think has become easier or tougher in the landscape of dating nowadays?
I was going to say, before we before I answer that, the way you talk about how in maybe in gay relationships there's a lot more, there's a binary, there's like gender roles being assigned, I'd like to think that's not happening too much in the heterosexual, in the straight dating scene. I feel like there's no clear rules about who's going to pursue who now, and who's going to, whose house someone's going to stay at, or who's pushing for marriage more than that. I feel like that's not really like there. Of course, there are certain differences remain. I mean, I think when you're, I would imagine that when it's two guys dating, you're less scared of each other's like strength and what the other person is capable of. I think for women that still remains a certain kind of concern. But I'd like to think that it's more equal gender-wise.
I've also noticed the whole settler reacher dichotomy is very strong with the gays also. Like, there's obviously someone who's like
a little more
in power in the relationship, and then like the others always strung around, like the whole Kabir Singh scenario, remember, like the whole people are talking about it, like he roughs the girl around and she's still like in love with him, almost like a Stockholm syndrome, right? Like, and that happens, like if you go to all these forums which again like on Facebook, like these Humsafar pages, like for example Yaria or Harmless Hugs, there's so many young boys who are like on there with broken English, but just like heartbroken because they fell for some guy and like he was a hot shot, and like they then turned out to be, like, you know, at the receiving end of the bargain, because they were not the ones who were being mollycoddled in the relationship. So
in that sense, I don't think anything interlaps with what's happening in the straight community. If you really, like, go there with how, like, the contrast between, again, I keep bringing it back to, like, gay dating and straight dating. But I feel like our set of problems will, whether it comes to STDs again, and because, you know, for us, it has to be, like, it's a big deal, right?
Yeah.
Like, just having consciously chosen to be safe, or, like, consciously not getting your heart broken, whatever it is, you know? But I feel like with some, because I've been in straight, I've been with girls before too. I just feel like I miss what I've dated boys now. I've dated girls now. I loved dating a boy because of the convenience of it. But with girls, I just felt like it was too demanding a lot of times, like, in terms of attention, in terms of, like, being considerate, in terms of being sensitive and all of that. I feel like that was a contrast.
In terms of what was expected from you.
Yeah, yeah. With boys, I just always felt like I could be myself more easily. But with, and again, I'm totally negating anything sexual in this. I'm just saying, me as a person, I felt more accepted by a boy than I was ever by a girl. So
because things were demanded of you that you weren't prepared to give, or that you felt you didn't come to you naturally.
No, I was naturally myself, and I felt like boys are okay with me being the way I am, but girls always had this need to change. You know, you need to be more this, you need to be more that, you need to...
Could that be a sweeping statement, though?
I'm not generalizing. I felt a lot of times... I get it. It's a me problem. It also pours into my gay relationships a lot of times, where I'm not considerate of someone else's problem enough. I'm not empathetic.
Considerate,
yeah.
I mean, I'd like to think fundamentally in straight relationships or heterosexual relationships, there needs to be a certain kind of understanding when it comes to how you show and express love.
Mm.
Because everyone wants to feel loved in that relationship. And what you're talking about is a woman who doesn't feel like you're matching her love language or giving her love and attention the way she wants it. And maybe you feel like you can do that more naturally in a gay relationship because your love languages align more. Maybe there's a certain security that you're being able to give someone that you can't give.
Yeah. I also felt it came from a little latent mommy issues kind of a thing where, you know, dealing with a girl was tougher than it was with a guy. I'm totally bringing this conversation down. Sorry. Mansher.
No,
Mansher.
Yo, what was your original question? I feel like I totally glossed
like,
over that.
What do you think do you think there's been a visible difference in the landscape of dating for you in the past couple of years?
Are we talking with me particularly or in
just
general?
You particularly? I want to know your perspective.
Let's see. I feel like people are a lot more down to date. People are a lot more like willing to like take chances. Yeah. People are a lot more willing to like make mistakes.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's something that's like so great to see and I think there's a great tendency to have a conversation about expectations before making assumptions right off the bat, which I think is so important. No one assumes monogamy off the bat once you have like sex.
Yeah.
No one assumes you're having a relationship off the bat when you're having sex. So I think being a part of a culture now where those conversations are happening and relationships are being kind of like pursued and constructed with so much more consciousness and intent is something that I feel is really new, really refreshing, really great to see.
Nice.
I also feel it's a subject of time though. Like, you know, like
it's the time we live in.
And when I was younger, I was more jaded. Like, you know, my first partner, I was like, okay, this guy's mine for life, you know. I remember we had this time capsule that was buried under our college building and it was supposed to be revealed after like 10, 20 years. And where I've like written down like, you love so-and-so person and he's the one for you. Even though he was 40, okay. I was 19. I'm like, even if this thing comes out of 20 years, he'll be dead by then. What am I sitting on his corpse?
Okay.
I don't know, living like that kind of lifestyle. So... the next boyfriend, okay. Then I went like to dating one more guy, and like again, like very homely, sweet boy. And after a month of like, you know, talking and
wait, you did a separate memory capsule for him also?
No, there was only one time capsule.
It's like you're leaving like a treasure hunt for yourself.
I mean, aren't all capsules time when
and they don't have to be physical?
Yeah, exactly. It's in your memory. It's deep down and it comes back like a anyways, so like this guy was all like, you know, like coffee dates, you know, walk in the rain, one umbrella, all of that. Very romantic stuff.
Terrible.
That's not romantic at all.
Wow. Just like bring everybody's morale down while we are being all cuddly and romantic. So after a month I got him home and I was like, okay, when my mom was not there, and we just like sat and watched pairs for Bobby. Which is essentially like a very hard... Yeah, he'd never watched like a Kuwaiti movie, and I showed him the most depressing movie of all time.
Oh God.
And I'm crying, and then like he kissed me and everything, and then we like...
I'm so sorry, go on.
Just like, yeah, which, my misery.
You cry, yes. I mean, you cry every time you watch that movie.
No, have you seen Prayers for Bobby?
I haven't seen it. Oh, you'll cry every time.
It's Susan Sarandon crying throughout.
No, it's...
sorry.
Aliens, Ripley.
Sigourney Weaver.
Sigourney Weaver is the one. Like she's,
and she has a gay son?
She has a gay son, and he kills himself, and then she has a whole like life-turning experience. But we're making out, and I look at him, and I'm like, are we fully committed or half committed? And he laughed at my face for 10 minutes, okay? Yeah. Because he didn't understand what question was that. Because after my first relationship, I was like, okay, do I want to really commit to one person? And then was my, you know, agony. And from there on, like, probably now, I've matured in a whole different sense of the term. Not just from watching movies or, you know, cutting with boys. So I just feel like it's a subject of time as well. Not only in your personal time, but the generation we are living in also at the same time.
I have a question for Mansher. You know, see, we have our pitfalls that we have to jump around, you know, in the gay community, whether, again, with whatever we deal with. But with consent and Me Too and so many things happening as a big conversation, is it something you, because you spoke about role playing, in, not role playing, but like...
gender binaries.
Yeah. Like, do you feel yourself being more careful? Or
I think every dude in the last like couple of years... has kind of reflected on their dating, their dating history, their relationships, who the people they were, how they made the women they were with feel. They've analyzed it, and sure, in some cases it's given you like things to think about, it's given you things to learn from, and I think even now you realize that you have to, even though consent is something that you aren't always going to explicitly verbally kind of get, you're primed to be more attuned to body language. I think maybe where it's still hard is that women are still under so much kind of pressure to present themselves a certain way and to maybe control their sexuality and not be as kind of like open and inviting when it comes to you know being physical and then having to kind of like deal with that and having to kind of be discreet, be understanding. I think that is something that's really, that people have got a lot more conscious about, if that makes sense.
That's a very...
Yeah, so one thing I also do is like I curate comedy at Habitat, which is a venue. And like we have like a bunch of comics, and obviously in the comedy scene, a lot of people are called out, and they were immediately like from the scene, they vanished almost because we were all like collectively, we have to make it safer for everybody. But then there's a comic, a good friend of mine, he... probably bullied a girl when he was like, you know, in 8th grade or later in college years. And since then he's grown up a lot. So somebody complained to us about like, how can we let him on stage? And then we also had to take a step back and be like, okay, does he actually, you know, matter, like in terms of if he also part of the Me Too movement, did him calling somebody something wrong in the past matter in that regard, or because he's grown up now and he's obviously understood his mistake and everything. So we did not know how to even tackle the situation because again, it's
because how do you decide whether he's actually like matured or no? Like,
so we're like, okay, let's take both parties you know, consideration, and let's not give him stage time, and let's not have them on our social media also. So everybody's happy.
So going back to what I said earlier, I still think it takes such a leap of faith for a girl to invite a man back to her house or for a girl to be alone with a man. I think it takes such a leap of faith and such a level of trust to be there, because anything could happen. And not only are you dealing with the fact that the consequences of sex fall disproportionately on the woman in case she gets like pregnant or in case society finds out or whatever, but you're also dealing with the fact that, like I said earlier, in most cases, this man can physically overpower you. I think for a man to be like mindful of that and mindful of the effect he's having on a woman is so important. It's always been important, but now I think it's important in a new way.
Tell me one thing, like as a gay boy and as fellow gay boys, we've always had to like hide our love, right? Like if you're even taking someone back to your house or whatever, you have to make sure that all the window curtains
are
closed.
Speak for yourself. No. Huh.
Like to an extent, you've like, it's cool to do it like chupke, but like when you know like you're walking from your lift to the door, you have to like maintain some sanity. Can bring a nice friend over, not like anything else. But if Hollywood movies are to be believed, like people start fucking macking in the taxi and then like they keep making
out.
So has it ever happened to you, is what my question is. Like, have you ever just like started macking in the doorway only?
So it's such a random question.
I know.
I mean, let me to answer, let me say that I feel more comfortable maybe expressing affection in a public way. Like, I hold hands in public, and I can go in for like a quick kiss in public and not think twice about it at all. And I'm not sure. I mean, I think you guys probably, I don't know, maybe it's not the same for you guys. But no, it's never been like that kind of like raunchy and kind of explicit in PDA. Public like that. I think that's a bit,
Some of the thing I've noticed is like PDA also like varies across generations. Not like some people love the fact that, okay, there's two people in love and expressing themselves. See, the old woman over here is sighing.
You don't like it.
I'm not into PDA.
Gia, my
like,
best friend we had on the show, even she hates the fact that people do PDA at all.
I can't stand it. I can't. A lot of times I find myself getting very, if you've been for gay parties, which you have, you know how like raunchy they can get. And I'm not even talking like your post pride and all to hota hi hai, but like I'm saying, what is that club in town? Voodoo. You know, that's like STD central. Like, even if you bend down, someone will start fucking you. It's like one of those places where everyone's going at it.
Yeah, there's a guy who's a urinal over there.
I can't. Oh my god. But you know what I'm talking about. I'm sometimes.
Wait, voodoo's not around anymore, right?
No, it's not. No.
Oh, okay. What a pity.
They shut the venue down and the guy.
Sorry, guys. That's my laugh deal. Oh my god. No, PDA was never not an issue.
No, how do you define PDA? Like, what happens in those clubs?
You know, I can define it because I'm into outdoor sex. Not in Bombay though, because it's not possible. I'm into outdoor
like
sex.
Like nature.
And yeah, so I understand what PDA is. Like, if there are people watching and shit, if it's in a...
That's not PDA, dude, right?
Yeah, it's not. So, but if someone else is witness to it, apart from like if it's an orgy and someone's an exhibitionist, voyeur type situation.
Yeah, that's voyeurism.
Yeah, then it's fine. But like, no, I can't deal with like, just like going at it in public. I've seen so many times, I was at Fatty Bao, the last Salvation Star, and two boys were asked to leave because of how heavy it was getting on the floor.
Yeah.
Like, hey, you have to not kiss. And I'm trying to imagine...
I think
the guy
same
who had
two
to
boys
tell
we
them,
mention every time.
But similarly, the way we like the way we talk about how PDA is maybe not that good in pub in public and shouldn't affection should be that openly expressed. I feel like turn a blind eye towards how discord and disagreements. We see couples. I see couples fighting so much or crying and having these like big dramatic
publicly,
like
very loud.
On bandstand especially, literally a crying couple like once a day.
Yeah,
and we just
and like again like the idea that you know women are so subjected to them to husbands sometimes. Like I was coming back from work late night once like 11 p.m. in the night and this woman is waiting at the bus stop and I'm also like it's 11:30 in Marol, okay, so it's scary, so I'm also like okay let me just wait till the bus comes, so she wants to wait for the bus, I'll also you know be here in that case. And soon a man pulls up on the bike before the bus comes and he's her husband obviously and he's calling her in Marathi for being late,
okay,
like not leaving work home like work late on time for home,
okay,
and then he takes his bike key out dude and starts hitting her on the road with the bike chain. And
he took his bike chain out.
Like as not the fucking chain that the bike gear runs on.
That's
like,
such
that
an inconvenience.
Thing, the rubber one.
Okay.
But you're sure that there was a husband and wife situation?
Yeah, I can understand Marathi, right?
Oh, so, okay, cool. Nice.
And he's talking about how he had to put his kid to sleep and like then take the bike out at night. Oh, he came like in his boxers. It's a typical scenario. And she was not saying anything. She was just wincing, obviously, with when he hit her. And then along with me, 2-3 more men were at the bus, obviously came like to stop it and everything.
Huh.
And she's like, it's okay. Mera marad hai. It's okay.
This happens so much, but I see like a fight happening and it's not physical, but even then, like the moment it gets a little physical, like you come in and there's certainly just the woman or someone is just like, no. Exactly. It's not your position to stop it because we have to respect what happens in those relationships.
No, I feel like it's okay to intervene, but the moment this happens, because it's happened to me twice where I intervened and the woman was very like, do not, you know, like this is my thing. Then I'm like, okay, you know, then I just retreat. But it has happened in the past.
But on the extreme end, we have the bandstand couples.
Like the
highway couples, right? Sure. Like where they're based on a bike and one chatri.
I feel
ki
so
niche.
Sad for them, especially when cops catch them and all. I'm like, why would you catch these?
But it's also like one of those situations where there's like 20 fucking couples, the cops will go to one of them, you know?
Of course, this couple will just take money.
But they found like proper like crevices to gusawa them and
on the rocks,
So I have a problem with like that babu shona PDA. You know what I'm saying? Like where like my babu ne khana khaya kya and like shona, how are you? That kind of fucking thing. being less annoying to me.
Yeah, fuck that. No. Yeah. I'm like no hickeys also. I'm there. So.
Yeah, my boyfriend and I call each other cunts all the time. That's much more.
But it is nice to kind of be able to, even when you show everyone on Instagram, when you have a picture of your significant other, it's nice to be able to declare your love to the world.
And delete it afterwards when you're done.
I don't think so. You know, I actually beg to differ. I feel like in a time like today where everyone can see your life, especially your relationship, how well it's doing and all. I feel like when it doesn't work out, I feel the pain is just... it's quadrupled or like 10 times worse.
Yeah, should I archive it or delete it altogether?
Yeah, archive or delete.
Awesome. So we'll take a small break at this point and we'll come back and we have Mansher here. Okay. We're keeping it queer, guys, and more dating problems on the other side.
Mm-hmm. Hello and welcome to another awesome week at the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We are at IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. Don't forget to take a screenshot of whatever podcast of ours that you're listening to. Take a screenshot and put in a comment about what you think about the show and we will reshare it from our social media pages. Here's what's in store for you this week. On The Seen and the Unseen, Amit Verma is in conversation with historian Srinath Raghavan. They talk about the complicated history of Jammu and Kashmir, the recent abrogation of Article 370, and what the future might hold. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam Gupta is joined by Vishal Sabarwal, EVP, e-commerce and digital marketing at HDFC Life. They discuss life insurance and its importance, different investment options offered by HDFC Life, and more. On Keeping It Queer, Naveen and Farhad talk to drag queen Sushant Divgikar about his journey of representing one's community and why is it important. On our Kannada podcast Thalle Harte, Varun Ramachandra talks to Pawan Srinath about his life in political sciences and political philosophies. On Football Shootball, Gaurav Karthik and Sivaram discuss the Manchester City versus Tottenham match. They touch upon the Neymar saga and Roberto Pereira dancing to Baziger O Baziger. On the Geek Fruit podcast, Jishnu and Dinkar break down and give their take on the brand new TV series The Boys. On Golgappa, host Trupti Khamkar is joined by Daniel Mendonca, a gender rights activist who talks about being sex positive and inclusiveness. He also shares his experience of representing India at the UN. On What a Player, Mikhail Akash and Siddharth talk about Chris Gayle breaking Lara's record, Kedar Jadhav's comparison with Vix, Rafael Nadal and his sneakers, Arsenal fans and a lot more. On Simplified, Chuck and Sriket talk to crossword setter for The Hindu Tony Sebastian about crossword puzzles and what goes into setting them. And with that, let's get you back onto your show.
Welcome back to Keeping It Queer, you guys. Here we are with Mansher discussing dating life and issues that surround us, like along with our domestic issues, obviously.
Sure.
We didn't want to talk about like people bringing their issues to the public, including romantic and otherwise.
Yeah.
But that's the situation we live in. Like in Bombay, especially, like you talk about couples having sex with their kids in the next room or like in the next chatai for that matter. Like, you know, it's crazy sometimes how lovemaking is never celebrated almost when your family's like, you know, very restricted with like romance. And then like I had this very hard to heart with my mom recently, where she was like, my whole reason I left home recently was the fact that my boyfriend and I put up a photo of us kissing each other. And my mom's like, that's wrong in my perspective. And I'm like, why is it wrong? She's like, how would you feel if we went out and did that? I'm like, I would fucking love it.
Yeah.
For a change, if you all just like hugged each other, kissed each other, just like slept close to each other, I would celebrate the fact that my parents have given each other that affection.
So her problem is with the publicness of it.
I know.
Okay, I'm asking. It's with the publicness of it or the homosexuality part of it?
That though, she's outgrown, obviously. Like in my private time, whatever I do is fine.
It's a little bit of everything.
Yeah,
of course. Like,
but majority, I guess, publicness. A lot of people. Why do you have to show this? Like, you know, I guess. That's
And I don't know why is the question to answer in that regard anyways, because it's such a culmination of so many feelings and, you know, all that what's going on in our life, especially because the photo was because of the Supreme Court verdict, right? And I was in Kolkata, he was in Bombay. We didn't meet for 15 days. When we finally met, that was our way of like doing something. Maybe it's not the right way of doing it. Maybe according to you it's wrong, but we felt right, you know. And I had to take the photo down as well because my family was like,
what?
Yeah, like vulturing around.
That's extreme. That you have to take it down.
And my boyfriend called me a chicken shit for doing that. Like, you talk so much about. Yeah, and I totally agree. But like, it was a weird time because there was, my sister said, you know, the fuck word when she'd never said it before. Like, she's very like, you know,
I get it. You have to be a little sensitive about their feelings too sometimes, even though you might be fully out. Like last week when I was talking to my mom, I felt like I got so many messages when Keeping It Queer was covered by Indian Express recently. I got so many messages. I just assumed that my parents would never chance upon this article. But we were talking on the phone and suddenly she goes like, I read your article, by the way. Mm. And I was like, oh, shit. Then after the phone call, of course, she was like, what is a podcast? All that sort of questions happened. But none of this gay shit, none of that. But after that, I found myself thinking so much like, okay, now she knows. Now she knows. Now she knows. You know
then
what
she
I
listens
mean?
To one episode and then like...
Fuck. Baskin Robbins, anus sex. Oh.
Including your family stuff, you have mentioned very clearly.
Oh
you know,
my God, they just changed the will.
No, and in fact, the last one, like last video where we released on my YouTube, I spoke about how my family was like kind of disjointed because my mom and dad traveled so much and never fell in love after 30 years of their marriage. Mm. And my father goes on my YouTube every day to check what I'm doing. How? So he's seen the video. But the point is, my mom said this for herself. Like, she vouched for the fact that, like, you know, sometimes you fall in love later in life.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes because of the Indian situation, you're married off and then it doesn't happen for a while.
Yeah.
And that's the other spectrum that is altogether not given the chance to date like we are, you know, not given the chance to make out or cuddle or PDA for that matter. Everything is like restricted for them. And here they live like very narrow, you know, blind-sided life.
Yeah.
And sanitized.
Okay,
but that's romance in the service of structure and stability and building a life together, right?
Yeah, yeah.
The romance that we do is for the purpose of like individual fulfillment and enrichment. And
it's temporary? And you feel it's temporary?
Of course it's temporary.
Yeah. I mean, after the point of dating in any relationship, you basically start exchanging passwords, right?
Sure.
That's no, never. I mean,
never. I mean, that's just you.
Metaphorically, you let the other person in more and more. Sure.
Yeah. Like, if you're at the ATM and they're behind you, don't do this key. Like, I'm putting my ATM away from you because you're a...
There should be that level of trust.
ATM pin is fine. Phone password, no fucking ways. No fucking ways.
I feel like if the things you want to hide from your significant other...
It's not even a hiding thing. It's just like... That's my bubble.
Some separation, you know what
I
mean?
It's my little shrine that I can go back. Like, I don't want her to see... I recently showed Mansher a video of a woman with extremely enlarged areoles for nipples.
Life wasn't the same after that.
Two guys fucking her in her areoles. That's how big they were.
Yeah.
And
what is an areole?
Like the areola, like the nipple, like
so
the,
how the fuck it inside?
They were that big.
They were bigger than our anuses combined.
I think it was prosthetics.
By your anuses combined. I am Captain Areola.
I think it was prosthetics.
Okay.
Okay, but regardless, you know, that's the kind of shit on my phone. No password. Ever. I literally have no when he asked me why do you have such a video, and I actually don't have an answer. I just have it because I've never seen anything. It's my little zoo.
What is scary sometimes of being in a relationship with someone for so long is that you feel your sense of self is completely subsumed with theirs and you forget how to be an individual. And I think that is a little bit dangerous. You can't get to that point. Like, so hide the weird fucking porn you watch from them, you know? And be able to like cultivate your own life and interests outside of that relationship, because then you will demand everything from that relationship and it will disappoint you.
Hey, I have a question for you. So, you know, we are such a hookup, and it's getting there. Even straight people are getting there, right? We are a hookup first kind of side of things. And I know that's not as rampant in the straight.
And I don't think it can, because as long as like there's a risk of pregnancy and like STDs and like societal judgment, it will never be the same as it is with gay people.
Yeah.
But
a woman
has so much more of like so much more to lose from hookup and sex than you know
like,
than a man does.
Very easily like slut branding happens very fast.
Yeah.
Even with us gays, like we are the first ones to call our friends sluts.
See, but here's the deal. I have a friend, she's extremely forward, she's ahead of her times, you know, she's very open to like someone she did not know today morning, afternoon Tinder swipe match, by nighttime she's hooked up with him. She's like us. Mm-hmm. She's a gay boy.
Mm.
I feel she deals with so much shit, not because she's made that transition, like where she's open and she's free to do whatever she wants. And I'm not even going in the, she gets slut shamed easily. She doesn't let that sort of shit bog her down. But what bogs her down is the fact that nobody else is reaching there quick enough.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
And like, then she will be the outlier.
Yeah, like she, and that's a real frustration for her. Like, why the fuck can I not just be my, I have fucking, I'm not even going to say needs. She's like, I'm fucking horny. I want to fuck all the time.
Yeah.
How do I play that out? Like,
Also, it makes me think of something. Maybe this is the wrong thing to say. Maybe it's a generalization. I think it's much easier for a woman to get sex than a guy on average.
I feel that a lot of times. I'm jealous of women all the time.
I mean,
no,
sorry,
not
that's
you
like,
getting
I guess
laid.
That's not... I mean, like, I feel like a woman has more romantic and sexual agency than a guy does.
Absolutely. I agree.
Especially because she has a lot more to lose. So
Sure.
And it means a lot more for a woman to want to have sex and hook up with someone than it means for a guy.
I get it. Yeah. That's. It's just, for us, it's just whittled down, beaten down to nothing. We just do it because we just are having sex all the time.
Yeah. That's true.
Oof.
Okay. It's easy. It's like, it's a... just like one empty release and you feel empty again.
And I think it's so cool. And I think why that is so cool about like it meaning so much, that act having so much meaning to it. I mean, it's how much you meaning you attach to it. Mm. Because even now, after kind of dating for the last couple of years and like being with people, even now, every time before I kiss someone or before I have sex with someone, it's a bit like, hey, you chose me? Like, it feels like the fucking first time. Because that level of like novelty, that level of like it's still there.
I've not felt that since 2005. Nah, it's just
headphones are running away from his head, the intensity with which he's head.
But okay, is there something you wish? Okay, do you think there's some problem that we might not be aware of in the dating scene? You know what I mean? Like something that's with us, it's high fun and it's like rampant.
Pregnancy.
Again, apart from pregnancy, I'm sure there are like. Are there any issues that we might not be touching upon here? Do you feel?
No, I don't know about issues, but I feel like sometimes dating in your late 20s, early 30s is fraught with a certain level of pressure because people are still in that mindset where they want to like settle down. Mm. They have expectations. Sure. They're trying to build a life with each other. Sure. I don't know if you guys have the same kind of stipulations or conditions that you guys are contending with, but I think when you're dating at this age, it's just like there's a lot more kind of intention that's attributed because because people have expectations. Like, for example, like maybe you're with someone who like wants to settle down, like have a kid, like the biological clock ticking is like a real consideration. So I think sometimes when you're dating at this age, you aren't allowed to just like kind of explore it and like find your rhythm. You come in and like, oh, well, this is like real.
One of my favorite things to do as a comic is like interact with the crowd, and there's always couples coming to shows, right? And the most common question is like, what's your situation? They're like dating. I'm like, how many years? So and so years. And the crowd automatically like they start pricking their ears as to like, oh, 4 years and they're still not married. Like, what's the scene with that? Yeah. And as a comic, like there's some judgmental comics will be like, oh, they're not married yet. Ha ha. Who's the chicken one, the man or the girl? And they both feel very awkward, obviously. Yeah, that's why people, couples voluntarily don't come in the front row anymore because of the fact. Yeah. And that's one point, like I hate this comic called Dan Ninen, but it's one thing he said was true though, that we berate the people who come to our shows to an extent because we put so much of society's expectations on them, because comics are like that. We are like a one walking stereotype sometimes.
Yeah.
And we do that to couples, and if they want to come forward and talk about their life, they won't. Hmm. Like in my show now, I open up entire conversations about lubrication, like if straight couples are using it or what are they using it. And people, because of the queer nature of it all, they trust me more than they would otherwise. And that's a good thing to know, that we can then get people to our fold and talk about these things which are very important without making someone feel shy to sex naked or to engineer to Laudu and all of that shit has to go. And I'm tired of it.
That's I go to comedy shows as well. This is just an aside, but I don't know, man. I think I'm just so scared of being laughed at. I saw the Nutty Professor. I don't know if you remember that scene where fucking Fat Sherman Plum gets like,
that is so sad.
Yeah, I remember ever since then I've just been like so
and by the most
of
chutia possible person. I remember that guy.
Dude, I mean like comedians can just fucking destroy you, and I feel like if you were bullied as a kid, you're in that audience. Oh, so just like, what?
Yeah,
there's a great Key and Peele sketch on this about
Key and Peele.
Yeah,
okay.
It's hilarious.
Oh my god, yeah, it's with the guy with the burnt face.
Okay,
make fun of me.
I have a question. We again, sorry, I keep doing this gay straight.
No, it's good. That's the theme.
That's the theme. Okay, just one quick thing. Have conversations like open relationships and all seeped into? Do you find yourself facing that way more? Because I have a few straight friends who started toying around with the idea. You know, like monogamy, open relationships, whatever, polyamory, stuff like that. Has it ever?
I mean, those topics are definitely like flooding the mainstream around people's minds. I think to know them and be open to them is very different than actually practicing them.
Sure.
So, I mean, I see it around people. Like, I think they're making movements towards that. I think it's people are confusing polyamory and open relationships because you can just be sleeping with a bunch of people and like still only like one person, and that could be polyamory where you're like in love with multiple people. And again, I can only speak in terms of what I do personally. Again, I don't think that I have the level of energy and time I'm willing to make that effort to invest in multiple relationships like that. Okay. I don't think it's feasible after a certain point, because if you want to kind of focus on yourself, focus on your friendships, focus on all the multitude of other relationships in your life, I don't think you can put this much effort into dating and like sex. Sure. That's personally amazing. But that's why I said earlier, right? People don't assume monogamy right off the bat. It's something that's negotiated, and yeah. I think just being able to like talk about it and seeing it as the flexible thing it is means that there's so much more open-mindedness towards different ways of being and being able to like not feel that commitment is just expected right off the bat.
That's amazing. So this is why I wanted you on the show.
Yeah, the Netflix show called Easy, which again tackles.
I'm such a great show. Yeah. Oh my god,
thank you for watching.
Such a great show.
Thank you. Have you watched
so,
it?
No, so many people.
And literally, one second, there'd be no Easy without High Maintenance. One of the best shows on TV right
now.
I
agree.
Best show on TV right now. Yeah. Yeah. So empathetic, so human.
Yeah. So Easy's definitely got like the right pulse of the young or whatever the couples who are like.
So universal. I mean, like it's like hip upper middle class Chicago, but so universal.
Yeah, like starting a beer company together, but also at the same time relationships. Like they're generally understanding relationships. Like what's it like for a lesbian couple? Mm. What's it like for couples who are like opening up?
Or a married couple that maybe doesn't feel the spark after
open relationships
years.
And then both of them hook up, but then like he feels insecure that she's hotter than him. Yeah. So she'll find someone better. Yeah. And then there's a three-way situation with Melanie Nickerman and Orlando Bloom. It's a great
Shut
episode.
Shut up. Orlando Bloom.
Yeah.
This is the first season. I feel people recommend shit to me, but if they just told me, oh, there's all Orlando Bloom in this.
You'd watch
or
it.
If Ready Player One is
because
20%
the words are not enough for you to like be convinced. Anyways.
Okay.
But yeah, easy to check it out because then like
sure.
I it's like the Black Mirror of relationships.
Yeah, too many people have told me about it. I am gonna check it out. Yeah.
Cool. So on that note, I think we should wind this episode up. Recommendation from today's episode is Easy, of course.
Yeah.
And you can check out Key and Peele sketches as well. Relationships. They're weird, but
they make life worthwhile.
They make life worthwhile. Yeah.
And life is terrible without other people in it.
Thank you, Farhad, friend Mansher, for coming on the show and having more optimism than Farhad ever have in the show.
You just called me Farhad, so fuck you. Okay,
hey, so
like
good to be here.
Fir and Phir. That's the only difference. I called you Farhad.
Prawns fried rice. Have you heard that one? Prawns fried rice. It's my favorite.
Anyways,
but thanks, Mansher.
No, not at all. This was so great. Yeah, it's a great conversation.
Should we do this repeatedly?
Yeah, we should.
Has too many good bits.
I can be the token straight guy. No, I'm kidding. But
yeah. Okay. We need more of those right now.
Right.
You can follow Mansher nowhere because he's
nowhere,
on social media.
Nowhere.
You can follow him home.
But see me on the street. I run on bandstand sometimes.
And you will. You will see him. Yeah. And you don't have to go up to him. He'll come
peek
up
out of
you.
A chatri from bandstand and look at Mansher running
while
in shorts.
Crying with your boyfriend.
Exactly. While ping the
cops. Or your girlfriend.
And and don't beat each other up, please, for the love of Christ. And be nice to each other.
Yeah, be good to each other.
And my name is Navin Noronha. I'm House of Noronha on social medias. Farhad Karkaria is Farhad Karkaria on social medias. You'll find us both. IVM Podcast has more podcasts for you to listen to. Check them out as well. There's a cool one called Dating is Garbage, which extends more of what we spoke about in detail with Surbi Baga, Abbas and Janam talking about their lives. My episode is also on Dating is Garbage with my boyfriend. We talk about our dating experience in length for the 8th month anniversary of our relationship.
We should get him here sometime.
We should.
Yeah.
When he's not sleeping. Bye.
Bye.
Hello everyone. Welcome to Tech Careers in the New, the new podcast series presented by Accenture. I'm your host, Shiladitya Mukhopadhyay. In this podcast series, we'll get you the latest and greatest in the world of technology that's shaping the future of business as we know it. We're talking intelligent platforms, cloud, AI, blockchain, extended reality, and a whole lot more. Every fortnight on Wednesdays, we'll have for you a hot topic with expert speakers from Accenture talking about top trends in the space, how these are changing the world and creating growth across industries. And importantly, we'll tell you how you can learn more, build your skills and expertise to grow and stay relevant in your career. Episodes out on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcast from.
नमस्ते मैं हूँ सौरभ चंद्रा
और मैं प्रणय कोटस्थाने
जब महफिल खत्म होते होते दरवाजे के बाहर पुलिया के ऊपर हम दुनिया भर की जटिल समस्याओं को सॉल्व करने में लग जाते हैं तो हो जाती है पुलियाबाजी
अब आजकल के अपार्टमेंट वालों ने तो कभी पुलिया देखी नहीं होगी पर आप फीलिंग तो समझ ही सकते हैं
तो आइए शामिल हो जाइए हमारी पुलियाबाजी में जहाँ प्रणय और मैं एक से एक इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक्स की तह तक जाएंगे।
आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस, बिटकॉइन, पाकिस्तान, मेडिकल एजुकेशन, करेंसी क्राइसिस, कभी हम दोनों के साथ और अक्सर स्पेशल एक्सपर्ट गेस्ट की कंपनी में।
सुनिए हमें IVM की वेबसाइट, ऐप या अपने फेवरेट पॉडकास्टिंग प्लेटफॉर्म पर हर दूसरे हफ्ते।